As a beginner investor, one of the toughest things you go through is not understanding if a stock is a good buy or not. Is the price too high? Is it cheap? Should I wait before buying? And on top of this, there are a lot of complex financial metrics which scare you even more. In today's video, I'm going to tell you about my top 5 metrics to analyze stocks. I find them extremely useful because it allows me to get a quick understanding of any company in just about 5 to 10 minutes. So let's begin. What is going on, everybody? My name is Arjun and welcome back to the channel. I'm gonna distract myself from all of the madness that's happening in the crypto world and talk about stocks today. Specifically about the metrics I use to evaluate different companies and determine whether they deserve a place in my portfolio or not. These metrics are part of a broader strategy called fundamental analysis, where you basically try and understand the intrinsic value of a stock. On this channel, I talk a lot about long-term investing and not trying to YOLO all of your money into Dogecoin hoping it'll quadruple in a week. So this fundamental analysis is perfectly suited to those more long-term investing decisions. Alright, so let's start with the first metric, which is the PE ratio or the price to earnings ratio. This is what I use as a first step to analyzing any stock. And it's probably the most popular valuation metric out there. It is the ratio of a company's share price to its earnings per share. I don't think the share price needs any further explanation, but the earnings per share is a company's profits on a per share basis. So if a company is trading at $100 and has an earnings per share of $4, then its PE ratio is 25. So essentially what the PE ratio is telling you is how much investors are willing to pay per dollar of the company's earnings. In this case, it's 25 times earnings. Generally, the rule of thumb that people tend to use is that if a company's PE ratio is under 20, then it is considered cheap. And if it's over 20, then it's trading at a more rich valuation. And these PE ratios are generally used to compare companies that are within the same sector or industry. Let's have a look at some real-world examples. IBM has a PE ratio of 24.21, and Microsoft has a PE ratio of 33.41 currently. Does this mean that you have to sell all of your Microsoft shares and buy IBM instead? Not necessarily. It just tells you that investors are willing to pay more for each dollar of earnings from Microsoft. Maybe this is because they think that Microsoft is still growing, it has more potential to expand its business into other areas than a more steady business like IBM, which just continues to chug along the way it has in the past. This is also the reason why you just can't look at one metric when you're analyzing stocks, but PE ratio gives you a pretty good first impression. Up next, we have revenue growth. The goal of any business is to continuously grow their revenues and maximize shareholder value. Revenue growth just measures year-over-year percentage change in revenues. I like revenue growth because it gives us a way to value companies that are a little more early stage or are yet to become profitable. If a company is not profitable yet, then obviously its earnings are going to be negative. And in turn, that means that its PE ratio that I talked about earlier is also going to be negative. A negative PE ratio isn't that useful to us. The good thing about revenue is that it can never be negative. So we can always calculate revenue growth for any company. For example, Tesla was not profitable until last year, 2020. And a metric that investors were tracking pretty closely was revenue growth. You can see here that they did a pretty good job of growing their revenues over time, which helped them become a favorite amongst investors today. Companies that are growing revenues greater than 10% every year are considered to be growth companies. So these would be your Amazons, Netflixes, and Shopifys. Whereas other companies that are growing revenues from around the 2 to 10% range are more traditional steady companies. You don't want revenue growths less than 2% because then companies are losing out to inflation. I've also found it useful to look at revenue growth over time. So if a company is growing revenues year after year after year, obviously that's a good sign. And if you want to take a peek into the future, what you can do is look at analyst estimates because they forecast out numbers both for the remainder of 2021, 2022, 2023, etc. So that gives you a good idea of what to expect for these companies going forward as well. Next on the list, we have the debt to equity ratio. This one is slightly different because it's a quality measure that you get by dividing the company's total liabilities by the shareholder equity. By liabilities, I mean the debt that the company owes, and by equity, I mean assets like cash and inventory, for example. An easy way to conceptualize this and think about it is to compare it to your home mortgage. So when you pay down your mortgage, you're essentially adding to your equity or ownership in the home. And the amount that's left on the loan is your liability or the debt that you owe. So when companies have high debts, this means that they have to be careful in how they're spending money in other areas. So you want this debt to equity ratio to be as low as possible. The rule of thumb that I tend to follow is that I avoid companies that have a debt to equity ratio greater than 2. This is, however, very industry dependent because, for example, if you take financial institutions, their debt to equity ratio is going to be high because they need to borrow money in order to lend it out. So just keep that in mind as you think about this metric. To show you some real numbers, you can see that Costco has a debt-to-equity ratio of 0.3, whereas a bank like Wells Fargo has a higher ratio of about 1.2. Fourth on the list is profit margin. This is a profitability measure that you get by dividing the net income by the total revenue that the company generates. It is a ratio of the bottom line profits to the top line sales of a company. So it essentially tells you how much of each dollar the company ends up keeping. Let's again have a look at some examples to understand this better. If I take a company like American Airlines, you can see that their profit margin is quite low. This is to be expected, because they have a large fleet of planes which are gonna guzzle up fuel and they also require maintenance. On top of this, they also have a lot of staff that they have to pay salaries to. So this means that their profit margins are gonna be razor thin. When you compare this to a business like Facebook, they're gonna have much higher profit margins because they don't have as much of an overhead. Facebook is an internet-based company with pretty low operating expenses. So that means that they get to keep more of each dollar that they make. Just keep in mind that these profit margins are unique to every particular industry. This metric is important because even with rising revenues, a company can have lower profits if it doesn't keep its expenses in check. On the other hand, a company can increase its profit margin through innovation and optimization even if its sales are constant. So this is a pretty interesting metric to keep track of. Lastly, in number 5, we have free cash flow, which is a company's ability to generate cash. It tells investors how much cash a company has after all of its operating expenses and capital expenditures are accounted for. When it comes down to it, we know that cash is king, right? If a company wants to pay down its debts or give dividends to shareholders or reinvest into growing its business, it's gonna need cash to do so. So companies that have a healthy, positive, strong cash flow are gonna be attractive companies. You can look at trends over time to see if companies are growing free cash flow year over year so that they can save, invest, or return more to their shareholders. For example, you can see that Apple has consistently been growing its free cash flow, whereas a company like Uber is yet to reach that stage. Another reason why you want to look into free cash flow is because other metrics like net income and earnings can be manipulated through clever accounting tricks, whereas free cash flow cannot. It's an honest view into how much money a company is really making. By the way, you should be able to find most of the metrics that I spoke about on any stock analysis website. The one that I like to use most often is Yahoo Finance. It has pretty much everything you'll need, and in addition, it also has a conversations tab, which can definitely give Reddit's Wall Street Bets a run for its money. So you will never be short of entertainment on there. Having a look at these metrics will give you a solid foundation to decide whether to invest your money. But looking at these metrics in isolation or just completely ruling out a company because some of these metrics look bad is not a great idea either. You have to look a little deeper than that. Successful investors use these metrics in combination with other strategies like evaluating competitors, understanding financials, looking into the management team, and researching future prospects of a company. Doing all of this gives you a well-rounded view of a company, and you can make a well-informed decision on whether it's worth investing your hard-earned money or not. If you thought this video was valuable, don't forget to turn that like button blue and subscribe to the channel for more videos like this. Appreciate all of you for sticking around right to the end. Thank you so much. Have a great day, and I'll see you in the next one. Peace.